Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Message in the Bones by Don Merriman. Narrated by Gina Rogers and Matt Godfrey. Chapter 1. Gabby. Freak is a nasty word. It burns like a slap. A group of teenagers sit behind me at the coffee shop tucked inside the superstore. Isn't that the psychic freak? One of them asks the others. My quiet evening of people watching with a mocha latte ruined, I turn on the teenagers. Didn't your parents teach you better manners? I demand from my seat at the next table. The two males and a young girl with a nose ring stare in shock that I confronted them. The boys look startled. The young woman has the good grace to look ashamed.
We're sorry, she says, fidgeting with her hair.
Tell her you're sorry, she says to her companions. They mumble something that can loosely be described as an apology. I turn back to my latte, my cheeks flaming in embarrassment. They whisper together, thinking I can't hear them. Ask her. One boy urges the other. Leave her alone, the girl scolds. I know what's coming next, the question everyone asks. I beat them to the punch. I don't know if you will win the lottery, I say loudly. The girl giggles. Choosing people watching from the coffee shop as a fun activity says more about me than it does about Riverbend, Indiana. But there isn't too much to do here. We do have an antique covered bridge and an amazing park nestled along a bend of the St. Joe River. I often run at the park. But a rainstorm took the park off my list of options for tonight. The rain must have driven the kids inside as well. At least they have friends to hang out with. My latte and a book keep me company. A very young boy wanders by the half wall, separating the coffee shop from the rest of the store. I forget the teenagers and focus on the child. His hair is the improbable shade of blonde only the very young are blessed with. And women spend hundreds of dollars trying to reproduce. His chubby face looks curiously around him, not scared yet, but working towards it. The closer I get to 30, the more I enjoy watching children, and this little guy radiates cuteness. Instinctively, I look for his mother, but he walks alone. He wanders past the half wall separating the coffee shop from the store, then totters towards the produce section and its bright colors. The delicate cross tattoo on my left inner forearm begins to tingle, telling me to act. Rubbing it through the fabric of my jean jacket doesn't make the tingle stop. I down the last of my coffee and leave the teenagers twittering behind me. I find the little boy near a display of dried fruit. Scanning the produce section, I still don't see a mother looking for a lost child. The fact annoys me. I kneel close to the little boy. We are alone between the dried fruit display and the organic tomatoes.
Hi there. Are you lost?
He turns his angelic face to me, cocks his head sideways.
Don't think so.
His tiny voice is as cute as his face. Where's your mommy?
Around.
He points to a package of dried apricots.
Can I have this candy?
That's not candy, honey. Looking around one more time, I can't find a frantic parent. I slip the glove off my left hand, the only hand that actually needs one. I rarely make a contact on purpose, but the insistent tingle of my tattoo forces me to make an exception. The boy puts his chubby palm on mine. I close my eyes and open my mind. Laughing, running. A shaggy dog, the sweet taste of candy, snuggling with mommy. So far, nothing helpful, just fuzzy impressions of a young boy's mind. I focus harder on mommy. Tall, blonde, safe. Smells like vanilla. What was mommy doing when you last saw her? I ask the boy.
Talking,
he answers simply. I do what I can with that, try to see what he saw. Tall, blonde, wearing a red jacket.
talking to another woman, not paying attention to the boy. Boxes of cereal behind her.
Let's go find Mommy, okay?
I slip the glove back on and take his chubby hand in mine, ignoring the pang of longing stirring inside me. The blonde mother talks to another woman in the cereal aisle, completely unaware her son had run off. He pulls away and runs to his mom.
Mommy!
I recognize the woman and groan inwardly. Lacey Aniston. She's on the evening news now, but I knew her before the nose job. She never needed one. Lacey was the prettiest girl in high school and made sure you knew it. I approach slowly, although I'd rather run away. Lacey finally notices me and nearly breaks out laughing.
Hey, look,
she says to her companion.
It's Gabby McAllister.
She makes my name sound like a bad word. I know the other woman, too. Ashley and Lacey were tight friends back in school. I force my feet to walk closer to them.
I found him in the produce section,
I say by way of explanation.
Really?
Bryce, did you wander off again?
Lacey says sweetly to the boy, unconcerned.
Hi, Gabby,
Ashley says politely.
How are you doing?
I shrug, not trusting her. Ashley pushes on.
How's your mom?
She's doing as well as can be expected, I answer vaguely.
I've thought about you guys a lot over the years.
Ashley glances at Lacey, then leans closer and lowers her voice.
I always wanted to tell you how sorry.
Stop any fires lately?
Lacey interrupts with the old joke, laughing openly at me. Ashley looks away uncomfortably.
Well, now you have your son back.
I motion to Bryce and shove my gloved hands deep into my jacket pockets. Lacey doesn't say thank you. I walk away calling, "You're welcome," over my shoulder.
Nice gloves, Gabby.
Lacey calls after me. Her laughter echoes off the cereal boxes as I leave. I resist the urge to run down the aisle. Once in the parking lot, I do run, but blame it on the rain. The worst of the thunderstorm has passed, but water pours down the windows of my beat-up Dodge Charger, blocking me from the world. I scream in frustration. The fire incident still stings after 10 years. In a town where little ever happens, mistakes like that stick with you. Except it wasn't a mistake. No one remembers that part. I was 16 at the time. Mom and Dad had been gone for over a year by then. My older brother, Dustin, and I lived with Grandma Dot, trying our best to pretend our life was okay. Dustin adjusted well to our situation. A star athlete on the basketball team and popular in school, he transitioned with ease. I struggled. My world shattered at 15, a delicate age. I started feeling things I couldn't explain with my left hand. Things I shouldn't know. I'd feared telling Grandma Dot, but she supported me and understood. She had her own version of my ability and said I got it from her. Our shared secret skill drew us closer. Dustin hated the whole concept of psychic ability. I tried talking to him about it once, and his open disgust taught me to keep quiet. The night of the basketball game, I had no choice. I sat with Grandma Dot in the stands, feeling self-conscious. The other kids were having fun together, and I only had Grandma to sit with. Dustin captained the team. I enjoyed watching him and supporting him, but had trouble getting into the game. I got restless and went for a walk. Roaming the halls of the school alone, I trailed my left hand along the wall, killing time until the game ended and we could leave. My hand slid along the brick wall, then across the metal door of a utility room. The metal of the door felt cool, but the shock of touching it nearly burned my hand. Curious, I put my left palm flat on the door. The jolt terrified me. Fire, smoke, heat. Fear, danger, run, run, fire, fire! I panicked. I admit that. I overreacted. I admit that too. But real fear pounded through me. Fire! I screamed, my voice echoing off the brick walls. A few people outside the gym looked at me curiously. Fire! Run! They looked around. No smoke. No flames. One man approached me to help, but I shot past him. I slammed through the double doors leading to the gym full of people watching the game. Both sets of bleachers full of cheering people, the players passing and shooting the ball, and the cheerleaders jumping through their routines on the sidelines were all in danger. Fire! I screamed in terror. I ran right into the court, instinctively going to Dustin. Everyone get out! The building's on fire! The crowd went silent. The cheerleaders stopped cheering. The players lost track of the ball and it bounced to the other end of the court. Every eye focused on me, except Dustin. He kept his back turned, too ashamed to look. No one ran to safety. I said the building's on fire! Everyone has to get out! I screamed at the bleachers. A few people stirred and headed for the doors, not willing to take the chance. Once they started out, a few more followed in a slow stream. The coach stormed across the court at me.
What are you talking about? What fire? The alarms aren't going off. We're in the middle of a game here.
Angry spittle flew from his mouth onto my face.
The utility room's on fire. Why won't anyone believe me?
I looked around in confusion, wanting Dustin. He kept his back to me and hurried to the far end of the court to retrieve the basketball. A strong, wiry arm wrapped around my waist. Grandma Dot.
Gabriella, what's going on?
I touched the utility room door. I saw fire.
Grandma Dot stiffened next to me, understanding.
Show me.
She led me off the court. Laughter rolled through the room. Countless angry mouths and uncaring eyes ignored the danger and laughed at me, the new joke of the town. Grandma Dot led me away. I looked over my shoulder for my brother. Dustin pretended he didn't know me. His betrayal stung more than the laughter from the crowd. People pushed past me to return to the game, giving me harsh looks.
You should be ashamed of yourself.
More than a few of them grumbled at me.
How dare you scare us like that?
One woman accused. Grandma Dot flashed her eyes at the woman and she scurried away. A man in a suit strode over with authority, his shoes clipping the floor in anger.
It's illegal to yell fire in a crowd for no reason. He barked at me. Not a funny prank, young lady.
Don't you threaten my granddaughter, Grandma Dot snapped at the man. If Gabby says there's a fire, then there is a fire.
The man started to say something, then shut his mouth.
Open this door and let's see, Grandma challenged.
The man hesitated.
I'll get the keys.
His shoes clipped away. Grandma Dot leaned close to my ear.
You better be right or we're in trouble.
I sensed fire. Grandma Dot touched the door herself and closed her eyes. Her powers aren't as strong as mine, and she shook her head. The man came back with the keys and slid one into the metal lock. He looked at me in warning before he opened it.
Last chance to tell the truth.
Open it, I said. He turned the key and pulled the heavy metal door. Chapter 2. Gabby. I held my breath as the key turned in the lock, afraid of what we'd find behind the door. The gray metal panel swung open. The sickening smell of burning plastic poured over us. Smoke pooled at the ceiling. The administrator cursed and rushed into the utility room. He grabbed a fire extinguisher off the wall and located the small electrical fire in the back corner. A short blast of the extinguisher and the fire went out. He joined us outside the door, coughing and waving at the air. He stared at me with a mixture of amazement and fear.
How did you know?
I squeezed Grandma Dot's hand, frightened that I had been right. I'm glad you put it out. I was scared, and no one was listening to me. His eyes narrowed with suspicion.
Did you start this fire?
Of course she didn't, Grandma Dot snapped at the man. How could she? The door was locked. The man backed away from me, not wanting to hear how I knew. The smoke had cleared from the room. He put the extinguisher back and hurried away, shaking his head.
Can we go home now?
I pleaded with Grandma Dot.
There's no way I'm going back to the game, and I'm never coming back to school.
It will blow over, Grandma Dot soothed. Things always blow over. But it didn't blow over. Grandma Dot made me go back to school, no matter how hard I begged. High school kids are cruel. Dramatically yelling fire when they saw me in the hall became a running joke. The rumor spread that I had psychically sensed the fire. The town ate that up. I had grown used to the sidelong glances and barely hidden comments behind my back when I lost my parents. Crazy, freak, and witch were just new words added to the gossips' mouths. Fake was another popular word. No one mentioned the fire was real or that I saved countless lives. Lacey Aniston enjoyed throwing it in my face tonight. Lacey had been a cheerleader at the basketball game and had a front row seat to my screaming on the court. I scream now in my car. I turn the key and the charger rumbles to life. I stomp on the gas pedal and head out into the country, hoping a drive through the cornfields will take the edge off my anger. The charger and I speed down the wet country roads, music blaring from the battered speakers. I yearn to see something new, to go where no one knows me. The rain stops, and I keep driving. The roads start to dry, and I keep driving. Four towns away, I stop for gas and a sandwich. I sit at a small table in the gas station, munching my tasteless ham and cheese. Strangers come and go. No one even glances at me. I bask in the anonymity. It's a straight shot down the four-lane highway to home, a much quicker path than the winding way I came. Much more traffic, too. A red Camaro pulls past me. Feeling ornery, I push the gas, hoping to get the Camaro to race. The charger rumbles louder, gains speed. I push the pedal harder, slide past the Camaro. It doesn't take the bait. Letting up on the gas, I slip back in line next to the red car. The middle-aged driver ignores me, unimpressed with my antics. He keeps his attention on the road as a responsible driver should. I'm not in a responsible mood. I slam the pedal and dart ahead with a little squeal of the tires. The speed intoxicates me. What's the point in being called crazy if you can't act crazy once in a while? Flying down the left lane, I pass a small car, a pickup truck, and a minivan.
Eat my dust!
I yell dramatically and laugh out loud at my childishness. Woohoo! A sedan rides up on my right. I push the gas even harder, ready to pass it in a flash. Pulling alongside the sedan, I look towards the driver, laughing and enjoying myself. I don't see his face. The insignia on his car door grabs my attention instead. Red and blue lights flick on, their intention clear. Crap on a cracker, I yell at the dashboard. Slowing down, I pull over to the gravel shoulder of the highway, fear swimming in my gut. The cop parks behind me and the officer takes his time reaching my window. Please don't be Dustin. Please don't be Dustin. I repeat as I watch the officer approach in my sideview mirror. My brother Dustin is the head detective with the Riverbend Police Department. Unlikely he's out doing traffic stops, but on a small force, everyone pitches in. The officer knocks on my window. I should have it rolled down already. I know the drill well enough. I push the button and the tinted window slides down, revealing crisp blue eyes and neatly cut hair. Thank God, Lucas, it's just you. Dustin doesn't have to pull over his crazy sister. Gabby, what are you doing out here driving so fast? Lucas Hartley leans his forearms on my open window. You could kill someone driving like that. My brother's partner normally smiles when he sees me, but not tonight. I didn't know you did traffic stops, officer. I school my face to look innocent and sweet, look up through my lashes and blink in an exaggerated way. Lucas sees through my ploy. Don't try that flirty stuff on me, Gabby. I know you too well to think you're serious. His face softens. It was worth a try. The smile on my face surprises me. Why are you out here doing traffic? No big cases to investigate right now? Olivia wants to take ballet lessons. I'm picking up a few extra shifts to help pay for them. How is Olivia? I haven't seen her in a long time. Sassy as ever and growing like a weed. She was here this weekend, but is back in Indianapolis with her mom now. I catch the note of longing in his voice. Lucas and Amber had a short, ill-advised marriage. He met her in Indianapolis on his first post as a police officer, but he brought her back to Riverbend to raise their daughter Olivia. Amber didn't like the small town life and soon left Lucas and headed back to the big city, taking Olivia with her. Lucas was well established in the police department by then and decided to stay on. He gets to see Olivia every other weekend. Silence fills the car. The red and blue lights dance across my dashboard. Lucas looks at my mouth, waiting for me to say something. A car rushes past us on the highway, bringing us back to the present. Lucas places his hands on the window. Right, speeding. You didn't tell me why you are driving so fast. Everything okay? His interest both touches and annoys me. Why wouldn't it be? He blows out air in exasperation. Have you been drinking tonight? Why is that always the first question you guys ask? I try on the sweet, innocent face again. Lucas chuckles, making his tool belt jangle. The sounds mix together nicely. Answer my questions, Gabby. Have you been drinking? I can give you a breathalyzer if I need to. You don't want to do that. You want to let me go home with a warning. I will drive slow and safe the whole way. Just like Grandma Dot on her way to church. This really makes him laugh, jangling his tools again. Don't drive like Grandma Dot, or I'll have to haul you into lockup. So I can go home then? I ask sweetly. He searches my face with his trained cop eyes, looking for signs of impairment. His eyes linger a moment on my lips again. I lick at the sudden dryness. I'll give you a warning this time, but no more late-night racing, or any racing for that matter. He straightens, removing himself from my open window. Thank you, Lucas, I say earnestly. You won't tell Dustin, will you?
I finger the edge of my jacket, waiting for his answer. I won't tell Dustin. Your secret's safe with me. Now go home and go to bed. He turns on his heel, raising a hand in a half-wave goodbye. I watch him in the side-view mirror, all the way back to his car.
Chapter 3. Dustin. My arms shake under the weight of the bench press. Two more and I've finished my reps for today. I lay back on the bench, focusing on the open rafters of my basement gym. Gritting my teeth, I push up. A low growl escapes as I lift the weight. I hold the weight above my chest, take a breath, and prepare to lower it again. I upped the weight this morning, another step on my personal workout plan. The first day at a new weight is the hardest, but also the most fulfilling. I lower the bar, careful to control the descent.
Dustin, you down there?
My wife's question breaks my concentration. I almost drop the weight, but catch it on the stand just in time. I continue staring at the basement rafters.
Dustin!
Her voice louder now, more insistent. Walker starts crying upstairs, the shrill, unavoidable cry of a young baby. Coming. Alexis stands in front of the sink, near the wide window overlooking our front yard. Bathed by the morning sun, she struggles to contain Walker. He flails his chubby arms, pushes against his mom, and screams his displeasure. A surge of pride and protectiveness wells up at the sight of my family. Here, let me have him. I take Walker and settle him against my shoulder. He lets rip another wail directly into my ear, then settles down.
Look at the mess he made on my new sweater.
Alexis dabs at a spit-up stain on her shirt.
Now I have to change it, you little stinker.
Alexis takes Walker's chubby hand and kisses it as she leaves to change.
How did your workout go?
She calls over her shoulder. Up the weight this morning. I follow behind her down the hall to our room. Alexis pulls off the dirtied sweater and tosses it into the laundry basket. She pulls another sweater out of her closet, wearing only a bra and her well-fitting pants. I enjoy the eyeful. Since Walker arrived a few months ago, I rarely get to enjoy her body. I'll take whatever I can get at this point. You look good in that outfit, I say, putting special meaning into my words. Alexis turns, steps closer, slowly.
Oh, yeah?
She arches her back suggestively, tosses the sweater over her bare shoulder, teasing in a delightful way. I reach to touch her bare skin, eager for the connection. Walker lets out a wail from my shoulder. I drop my hand, mood broken. Alexis snaps back into mom mode, slips the sweater over her head.
I've got to get going. We have baby class this morning.
She takes Walker from me and kisses my cheek.
I made your lunch. It's on the counter.
I grab her hand to keep her from leaving the room. Pulling her close, I kiss her on the lips. She sinks into the kiss. Finish this later, I suggest.
Love to.
We both know it probably won't happen, but it's nice to think it might. I shower my workout sweat away and put on my uniform. My pants button a little easier today. Alexis's diet and my workout plan must be doing the trick.
Can't have the next police chief getting out of shape,
she'd said in her well-meaning way. I don't care how my pants fit, but if it makes Alexis happy, then I'm happy. My tool belt settles on my hips with a satisfying weight. I check my gun in its holster, the weight of the Ruger even more satisfying. My lunch waits on the counter. I don't look inside. I'd rather be disappointed by the raw vegetables and fruit slices later. The October sky reaches over my neighborhood in a shade of blue improbable for this late in the year. Indiana weather is unpredictable, the changing of the seasons more of a suggestion than a set rule. Yesterday it stormed, today the sun shines. The heat and the blue sky contrast with the orange, red, and yellow leaves on the trees. I pause by the door to my cruiser, turn my face to the morning sun. A chorus of shouts echo around the houses of my neighborhood. Frantic voices shatter the beauty of the morning. Putting my hand on my holster just in case, I run towards the sounds coming from behind the houses. Our street is the last street of homes they built in this neighborhood. Beyond lies an open field of another property. This past week, they started moving dirt and working the field in preparation for another housing development. I run across the backyard towards the shouts on the other side of the tree line, my mind taking in the details as I go. A bulldozer idles, smoke coming from its stack. No driver in the seat, but the machine idles quietly. Doesn't look like an accident there. Some workers mill around the dozer, but no one's laying on the ground, no major injuries. The workers circle around a low pile of dirt, and another man tries to keep them back. One of the men spots me running towards them and jogs over to meet me. It's a guy I picked up on a disorderly conduct charge a few months ago. Lester something. Officer McAllister, he says by way of greeting. It's Detective McAllister now, but I don't correct him. What's going on, Lester? I heard shouts. The dozer found something. Lester is jumpy and sweating. What did it find? I ask pointedly. Bones. The way he says the word chills me. A ripple of excitement tingles down my arms. Human bones buried in a field, and I'm first on the scene. I can't wait to tell Alexis. Approaching the dirt piled up by the bulldozer, I put on my best cop voice. Okay, everyone, back up. Give me some room. The workers obey and watch me from a short distance. A large bone pokes out from where the dozer turned the ground. A few smaller pieces litter the dirt, broken by the dozer. Looks like deer bones. A little wave of disappointment washes over me, triggering guilt. I put on a glove and brush the dirt away from the largest bone. It slides out of the pile, broken. Maybe a femur. I brush some more dirt away and reveal a few more broken pieces. Should we call 911? Lester asks. Give me a moment to figure out what we have. It might be a deer or something. I shuffle closer to the pile. Still crouched low, ignoring the twinge of an old basketball injury in my right knee. I dig deeper, and a hand emerges. The excitement tingles again. A rounded piece catches my attention. Moving faster now, I expose some more. It looks like a skull. I should leave it, should call in the forensic team. Instead, I tug it as gently as possible. The skull pops loose and rolls down the dirt and bumps into my foot. Startled, I land on my rear. The skull rolls against my outstretched leg, the sun glinting off the forehead. It smiles up at me with its unmistakable grin. It doesn't take long for my team to arrive. My team. I like the sound of that. My partner, Lucas Hartley, arrives first. He hands me a large takeout coffee cup. Thought you might need one of these this morning. Expecting plain, bitter black, the sweet, creamy latte surprises me. Lucas knows Alexis has me on a diet. My favorite fancy coffees are off limits, especially with the extra pumps of caramel. I raise my eyebrows in question. Lucas shrugs conspiratorially. I sip the latte gratefully and ask, did Pete find anything in missing persons? Nothing matches. He's going to check with Fort Wayne, too, but it's a long shot. These bones have been here a long time. Takes several years to be just bones. That's a wide search. We crouch next to the bones, and the gravity of the case crashes in. I get the strange sensation we're two kids simply playing detectives, not the actual detectives in charge. The initial excitement of the find is worn off, replaced with the impotent fury familiar to law enforcement. This person deserved better than a bullet in the head and a dirt grave in a field. The burden of finding justice weighs heavy. I resist the urge to dig further into the dirt pile. The femur, the hand, and the skull clearly visible now. Lucas inspects the scene. "We have nothing to go on," he says quietly. I'm glad he said it, so I didn't have to. Forensics will find something. Hopefully. His voice lacks conviction. After a moment, he continues. "You know, she could tell us something now," he says carefully. "No way. I'm not dragging my sister into this. But she could help us," he says evenly. Lucas knows my feelings about Gabby and her gift. Gabby and I keep our distance. I have fought long and hard to earn my position as detective and respected policeman, despite being dragged down by the town crazy. I don't want her near me or this case. The words come out harsher than I intended. "So what's your plan then? Hope something falls out of the sky to get the investigation started? We don't know how long this body's been here, let alone who it is. We don't even know how this person died. I want to do what's best for the investigation, but using Gabby?" Lucas senses my hesitation. "I can call her if you want. She likes me. She doesn't like me," I say simply. "Think how proud Alexis will be when you solve this case, knowing you used everything available to help." He's pushing it now and knows it. But it works, damn him. I have to deal with Gabby. So what? I think of Alexis and Walker and what's best for them, and pull out my cell phone. "Sometimes I hate you," I grumble to my partner. Lucas smacks me on the arm. "You're a good man, McAllister." The call goes to voicemail. I stab at the screen, impatient to hang up. She didn't even answer. I shove the phone back in its case on my belt. "Call her again in a moment. She will." Hartley looks pleased with himself. I want to punch him. I stare down at the skull and focus on the job before us. A few minutes later, I call Gabby again.
Chapter 4. Gabby. The beat of the music pounds in my earbuds, matching the beat of my feet pounding on the jogging trail along the river. The early sun sparkles on the river to my right, a blanket of rippling gems. The morning is perfect, marred only by the chafing on my heel from my new running shoes. I push on, enjoying the music, the air, the sun. I lose myself in my run, alone with the trail and my willpower pushing me farther. An incoming call intrudes through my earbuds. I slow my pace and check the screen. Dustin. My wonderful mood pops like a balloon. I resent the power Dustin has over how I feel. Hitting ignore call, I push on with my run.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.